Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. 6 days before Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. They gave a dinner for him there, and Martha served, while Lazarus was one of those reclining at table with him. Mary took a liter of costly perfumed oil, made from genuine aromatic nard, and anointed the feet of Jesus and dried them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the oil. Then Judas the Iscariot, one of his disciples and the one who would betray him, said, "Why was this oil not sold for 300 days' wages and given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief and held the money bag and used to steal the contributions. So Jesus said, "Leave her alone. Let her keep this for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." The large crowd of the Jews found out that he was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. And the chief priests plotted to kill Lazarus too, because many of the Jews were turning away and believing in Jesus because of him. The Gospel of the Lord. Today is Monday of Holy Week, so oftentimes during Holy Week, what I like to do is talk about what Jesus was doing during Holy Week. So we had Palm Sunday yesterday where Jesus came riding in on the ass, and the people were placing the palm branches in the streets before him. He was riding on an ass as, first of all, a sign of peace, right? When a king would come back from victory in war, oftentimes they would ride on an ass, signifying that they had won peace for the people. So this is what Jesus was doing on Palm Sunday. He was also fulfilling a prophecy of Zechariah. Zechariah was very often quoted in the Gospels because he spoke often about the coming of the Messiah. And one of his prophecies is that you would see the king coming to you riding on an ass. Right? And so that is what Jesus himself did. Likely when Judas Maccabeus, a couple hundred years before the coming of Jesus in the book of Maccabees, likely when he came back into Jerusalem after he had won victory for the people against the tyrannical Antiochus Epiphanes, likely he was probably riding on an ass as well. Right? So there's some significance there. But what was Jesus doing the rest of the week? What was Jesus doing on Monday of Holy Week? We know that on Monday and Tuesday, Jesus cursed the fig tree, and he went into the temple and turned over the tables of the money changers, and he started giving many different parables, right, in the midst of the temple area. And so those are some of the things going on at the beginning of this week. So just kind of taking these one at a time. Tomorrow we'll talk about the cleansing of the temple. But on Monday, right, Jesus entered into Jerusalem, and as he was passing by, he saw the fig tree that was not bearing any fruit. In fact, the gospel says that it was not the time for figs. And Jesus cursed the fig tree. And you might remember that the next day, as the disciples were walking past that fig tree, they marveled at the fact that the fig tree had withered. Jesus had cursed it, and he had said, "Let no fruit ever be born from you again." And sometimes we read this in the gospel, of what happened on Monday of Holy Week, and it seems kind of strange. Why would Jesus curse the fig tree, especially since it wasn't even the season for figs? And many scholars actually puzzle about this too when they comment on it. One of the reasons why Jesus cursed the fig tree is because the fig tree had a significant place in the Jewish understanding of salvation history. And oftentimes this is missed on us as modern readers of the Bible. Many of us, when we think about the book of Genesis, when Adam and Eve ate of the fruit of the garden, we have images of an apple in our mind because many different children's Bibles and artistic depictions, it seems like it's an apple tree. The book of Genesis does not clarify what kind of tree it is. It just says that they ate of the fruit of the tree. But Jewish tradition, the ancient rabbis and other ancient sources, they interpreted the tree of the knowledge of good and evil as a fig tree. Because right after Adam and Eve ate of the fruit of the tree, then they sowed fig leaves together. Where did they get those fig leaves? Presumably from the fig tree. Likewise, the ancient rabbis also assumed that the tree of life in the Garden of Eden was an olive tree, since oil has certain healing properties associated with it. You saw the tree of life, which could bring healing, as an olive tree. Kind of interesting. So one of the reasons why Jesus cursed the fig tree is he was making a statement not just about that particular tree, but as the new Adam, again, he was cursing this tree that caused so much pain and suffering and sin all the way back in the beginning. And he cursed it, asking that no one would ever eat of that fruit, the spiritual fruit of sin again. So that's what Jesus did on Monday with the cursing of the fig tree. And tomorrow we'll discuss the cleansing of the temple that Jesus performed as well.